Australian by Andrew Puckett. Read by Anton Rogers.
Rain. The hypnotic beat of the wipers. I never pick up hitches as a rule, but this one gave me no choice. He turned when he heard me and stood in the middle of the narrow tree-lined road, his arms outstretched. I pulled up and buzzed down the window of the borrowed BMW a couple of inches.
"Sorry to be so pushy," he said,
leaning an elbow on the car roof to speak through the gap.
"But my car's broken down. Maybe you noticed it, a Jag, a mile or so back."
Nasal Australian accent, dripping hair.
"No, I didn't." Well, I surely appreciate a left to the nearest garage. Not much traffic along this road."
"No, that's why I'd taken it." Perhaps I should have driven off at that stage, but I'd already hesitated too long.
"All right, you'd better get in."
I pulled on driving gloves as he moved around the bonnet, his feet slipping slightly on the wet leaves that had fallen from the trees. He opened the door and climbed in. I reached out to turn the radio off and then thought, why the hell should I? I like classic FM better than I like Australians.
"Thanks," he said. "I really appreciate this."
He was gangly, about 6 feet, with close-set brown eyes and a long face. He smiled, showing prominent teeth.
"That's all right," I said, as I let in the clutch.
It wasn't all right. He was drenched, dripping water everywhere. Charles will be pleased, I thought wryly, as it soaked into the seat and carpets.
He pulled out a handkerchief, mopped his face. "Where's the nearest garage, do you know?"
"And not offhand. Probably not until we get to Dunfield, the next town."
"How far is that?" he demanded.
"Oh, 8 or 10 miles.
"Sorry if I'm putting you out."
He didn't sound sorry at all.
"It's all right."
The water was evaporating from his clothes, fogging up the windows. I switched on the demisters.
"You see, I have to get to Dover today sometime. It's important."
"Really?" Dover was where I was going, to catch a ferry for the continent, but I wasn't going to tell him that. I don't like Australians much anyway, but something about this one really set my teeth on edge. ESP, perhaps.
"Yeah," he continued. "If the garage can't fix it, maybe they'll hire me a car. They have cars for hire there, don't you, do you know?"
"No, I'm afraid I don't." I changed down for a sharp bend.
"You see, it's really important that I get to Dover today."
"Well, you can always catch a train from Dunfield."
"Is the station near the garage?"
"Yes." I had no idea, but I'd already done him enough favours. There was a short silence. Not a silence at all, really. The beat of the wipers, the hum of the demisters, the slick noise of the tyres on the road and wet leaves. The opening bars of Beethoven's Fifth on the radio. I turned it up slightly, hoping it would prevent him talking any more.
"Never realised there were places like this in England," he said. "I mean, so close to London. Kind of got the idea that all England was like London, you know?"
I didn't say anything. His voice was becoming like a bow saw across the strings of my nerves.
"Course, in us, we got thousands of miles of it. Space, I mean," he chuckled. "Not with this kind of weather, though."
"No." I reached forward and turned the radio up again.
"You like this piece of music?"
"That's right."
"Seem to have heard it before myself. What is it?"
"Beethoven's Fifth."
"Fifth what?"
He couldn't be that thick. He had to be putting it on for some reason.
"Symphony." "Oh, yeah, great."
He started tat-tat-tumming along with it. Even that was preferable to his talking. I tried to close my mind to him and concentrate on driving faster, the more quickly to be rid of him. I glanced at the clock. Should make Dover in time for the midday ferry. France in 2 hours. Spain in what, another 10? The car skidded sideways on some mud. I twisted the wheel to regain control.
"Steady on, sport. Let's get there in one piece, eh? Like me to drive for a spell?"
"No, thank you," I said with difficulty. "Not far to Dunfield now." I could feel him looking at me speculatively. I swallowed. Clenched the wheel. With a crescendo of French horns, the movement reached its finale as I sighted Dunfield below us, sighed with relief.
"What a lovely piece of music. Now don't go away, because we've got the second movement coming up just after a couple of minutes."
Advertisement for a skin cream.
All we girls want is lots of lovely moisture.
Ah, bloody har, I thought, hysterically, as the rain splattered against the windscreen. News headlines.
The body of Mrs. Deirdre Sheffield, the Australian heiress, has been discovered in her home in Finchley.
I tingled, as though I'd been touched with a live wire.
The police are anxious to trace her husband, Mr. Paul Sheffield, who is thought to be driving a Jaguar XJS and may be trying to reach Harwich, where he has a boat.
I didn't dare look at him.
The police say that Mr. Sheffield, who is described as being 5'11", with brown eyes and hair, and whose little finger on his right hand is missing, should not be approached under him.
Couldn't help it. Glanced across at him. Made eye contact. Saw that he knew that I knew. I had to kill him. He'd seen my hand. Besides, I can't stand Australians.